host the COP27. Anything in the sustainable realm that's going to be of interest, and we're interested to hear how that's playing out. But Your Excellency, we really do look forward to hearing from you. But I first want to turn the mic over to, as I mentioned, our good friend and partner in all things Egypt, Hisham Fahmy, for some initial welcoming comments as well. Hisham?
Thank you, Steve. And good morning and good afternoon, everybody. On behalf of AmCham Inc. and AmCham Egypt, I welcome you. It's always great to welcome the minister, whether virtually or in person. Since we last met, I know you have had many developments that you have instituted in your ministry, very quickly, whether it's customs or ACI, as Steve said, or others. So we really look forward to updates on all those issues. But also, I think we're very interested in globally there are coming many challenges. And these challenges, like the price of oil, which has jumped tremendously, and I know that has an impact on our budget. The price of commodities, wheat, corn, and the supply chain impediments, interest rates. We really look for you to comfort us on what Egypt's going to be doing and what you're going to be doing to face those challenges. Again, look forward to your participation. Thank you.
Hisham, thank you, and Your Excellency. I'll be brief in the introduction, but most importantly, I just want to say thank you for your open door policy, your collaboration, and the close cooperation with the private sector. We think it's so important to have that type of partnership, and you're at such a critical post there as the Minister of Finance in Egypt. So we're grateful for your policy and the approach that you take to building consensus and working with the private sector. For those who don't know, that the minister, prior to his appointment as minister, was Vice Minister of Finance for Public Treasury Affairs and the head of the Economic Justice Unit. In addition, he's also served as the first Deputy Minister of Finance in 2015, and prior to that, as the Deputy to the Minister of Finance for Pension and Social Insurance. He's had several different positions, and really, in his over three decades of experience, really brings such a wealth of knowledge and expertise to the table. Minister Maait, thank you so much for being with us today. We're going to turn it over to you to hear from you on your latest perspectives, as Hisham was referencing, on some of the reforms and activities that you've been a part of and driving there in Egypt at the ministry, as well as any thoughts you want to share on some of those more macro global issues as well. So, Your Excellency, the floor is yours. And I know we also have your slide deck, and we're ready to offer that at your instruction. Thank you, Your Excellency.
Thank you very much, Mr. Steve, and thanks, Mr. Hisham. And let me, first of all, I will make a presentation in half an hour about Egypt fiscal policy response, a year in review, and the future outlook. And after that, we can comment on the points mentioned by you, Steve, and Mr. Hisham. And we're looking forward to receive a question from participants to clarify many of the issues. With regard to the presentation, we have some items here today to mention: COVID-19 and our response, macroeconomic situation with the impact of COVID-19, also Egypt fiscal policy for the current financial year 21-22, and performance at global scale, and key challenges, targets, and reform. If we start with the first one, which regard to COVID-19, government of Egypt designed a balanced policy framework which dealt with COVID-19 implication to dampen negative impact of the economy and the people's life. Since the president announced the 100 billion Egyptian pound stimulus package of 2% of our GDP, which we adopted targeted actions addressing most vulnerable sectors and households. And we tried to be transparent with the ongoing and open communication with the public. We also adopted a balance to strike balance of supporting the economy, but avoiding creating physical and debt imbalance, and using temporary measures to allow proper exit and readjustment as needed. The key pillar of that response was policies to maintain macroeconomic stability, such as mobilizing additional pro-growth revenue through automation, adoption of green fees, enhancing progressivity of personal income tax regime, prioritizing expenditure, and increasing infrastructure and human development spending. We also supportive and targeted measures for most affected sectors, for the vulnerable groups. The Treasury adopted measures such as providing adequate support to manufacturing, exporting activities, contractors, as well as tourism and aviation. We secured adequate financing to address the pressure on our hard currencies, and we issued the green bond of $750 million. In addition, we issued also euro bonds last year in May of $5 billion. Also, we made a request for the IMF, and we received the rapid financing instrument for $2.8 billion, in addition to a program of 12 months standby arrangement was for $5.2 billion. In addition to that, we issued this year $3 billion euro bonds, and also arranged last year a $2 billion loan from group of banks, which we paid off last August. And we trying now to arrange an additional $2 billion green and Islamic loan. If we look at the sectors which mostly benefit from the package, health and education was the most important over the period of the COVID-19. In addition to that, culture, aviation, industry, exporters, all of these sectors were supported, in addition to seasonal and casual workers, which we made the cash transfer to them for around 6 million people over this period. Egypt succeeded in also initiating some initiatives which addressed the COVID-19 impact, in addition to addressing the SDG good practices. These initiatives, such as A Decent Life, or Haya Karima in Arabic, which announced by the president. Also, a big project was the World Bank for Local Development Program in Upper Egypt. Upper Egypt has poorest areas in the country. Also, integrated system for preparing and following up huge investment plan for infrastructure. But the most important initiative is Haya Karima project, or the Decent Life. This project is for $50 billion over a period of 3 to 4 years. $50 billion for a period of 3 to 4 years. And this is going to change the life of around, let me say, close to 6,000 villages, with around 60 million or 60% of our population in the most poorest area. It started this in June 2019 with 375 villages across Egypt. The second phase started this year in January, and this phase, which started in January, it targets 1,500 villages which will represent 20% of the population. The third phase, which might be next year and the year after, will target 4,584 villages, which will represent more than or around 50% of the population. All of these will be between 700 to 800 billion Egyptian pound, which is around $50 billion. We are aiming to achieve the following objectives. Number one, improve living standard and invest in health and education of for the people of these villages. Also develop infrastructure services, raise quality of human development services, and also make economic development for these poorest villages, which will create also hundreds of thousands of jobs in these villages. This project was regarded by the World Bank as one of the best projects for achieving SDGs goals, which we are proud of that. And we believe this will ensure that in the coming 3 to 4 years, Egypt will have reduce the level of poverty, improve the human capital and health and education in particular. If we move to the second item in our agenda, Egypt macroeconomic situation and the impact of COVID-19, we look at GDP growth before COVID-19. We were 5.6 and we were aiming to 6%. With the COVID-19, we achieved only 3.6 in the year 2019-2020. And in the year finished 3rd of June 2021, we achieved 3.3. And the last quarter, we achieved 7.7%. This year, we are targeting around 5.4 to 5.6%, which we believe we will be able to do it, inshallah, around this range for real growth rate for our GDP. Unemployment, which declined from 13.3% in 13-14, reached 7.9 before COVID-19, and the first year of COVID-19 jumped to 9.6, but now is around 7.2-7.3%. Hopefully, will decline further in the coming period. If we look at inflation also the highest was around December 2016. Headline inflation was around 23.3 and the core one was 25.9%, and the food inflation was around 40.3. Since then, the inflation was declining, and in June 2021, the headline was 4.9 and the core 3.8. But unfortunately, the latest figures announced a few days ago, now we are around 6.6% as a result of what is going on of higher prices for higher prices for commodities, oil and electricity and all of that. If we look at the private sector and the credit to the private sector, we find that the credit for the private sector was picking up until February 2021. But after that, April and June 2021 declined to 19.1%. FDI's flows by sector declined for all sectors except manufacturing, which grew at 5.8% for the period 2020 to 2021 over 2019-20. And also IT and communication also achieved a very big jump, FDI influenced by the for the IT and communication sector. And we have good news that we bought our biggest IT owned by the company, which called eFinance. We bought it yesterday, and today IPO, which was covered, and so it was around 26% was offered, and it attracted huge demand. And I think some of the biggest name in the wallet invested in that, and we were able to sell for around in foreign investment, $230 to $240 million. And I believe also the public here have a chance to buy. And this the door is still open, I think, until next week. And we have other companies in many sectors will be going IPO in banks and insurance and petrochemics and many other sectors will be gradually going to the market in the coming months. This IT company was the first yesterday and today. If we go to the next page, overall deficit of our budget. Overall deficit was at the high, the budget deficit was at the highest 12.5% 15-16, and since then it is on a decline. We finished 2021, the financial year, the latest financial year, 7.4%. Without COVID, we should have finished 6.3. However, this year we are targeting 6.7%. I think it's a good achievement that we still have overall deficit declining. The same for primary balance, which was primary deficit 3.5% 2015-2016. But since then, we are achieving, since 2017-2018, we are achieving primary surplus. Last year, we finished 1.45. We should have finished 2% last year and the year before, but with COVID-19, we wasn't able to achieve it. However, this year, we are targeting 1.5% primary surplus, and next year and the year after, we will be targeting 2%. If we look at the graph in front of us, which shows how much we are effective and what we spend as fiscal stimulus in comparison with what we achieved as the GDP growth. According to the IMF World Bank, IMF World Economic Outlook, October 2020, we were one of the best efficient country on what we have spent and what we have achieved as GDP growth. If we go to the next page, you will see that Egypt was the only country in Africa and the Middle East that maintained its credit rating confirmation with a stable outlook by all three credit rating agencies, Moody's, Fitch, and Standard & Poor's. Also, this was appraised by the international institution, financial international institution, IMF, European Bank, and the World Bank, all of them regarded Egypt's swift response to COVID-19 as efficient and was good and effective. If we move to the third item, which was Egypt fiscal policy for the current financial year 21-22. I will look at some of the slides and give my colleague, Mr. Ahmed Kojic, Vice Minister, to complete. Let me say that for the current fiscal year, we adopting three objectives. Number one, ensure fiscal and debt sustainability. Number two, improve effectiveness and efficiency of revenue and expenditure. Number three, support high job rich economic growth. With that, we look at the page on the slide in front of us, which shows that for the overall deficit, we are targeting this year 6.7, and the following year, 2 years, 6%, 5.1%, primary surplus this year, 1.5, and the following 2 years, we are targeting 2% primary surplus. We are trying to keep always the annual growth rate of revenue moving higher and faster than the annual growth rate of expenditure. We achieved that since 2016-2017, except for the financial year 2019-2020 with COVID-19, we witnessed that expenditure was higher than expenditure growth was higher than revenue growth. But last financial year, we finished annual growth of revenue 11.6% compared to expenditure growth rate 8.6%. This year, we are targeting a growth rate for revenue 25.4%, and for expenditure 18%. My last page is about taxes. Let me say that the most contributor to the improvement in our annual growth rate of revenue is what we have achieved on improving tax collection efficiency through improving our tax administration and also the automation. So automation and widening tax base helped us to mobilize and collect more revenue and more taxes. As we can see, we have achieved growth, and this year we are expecting that annual tax growth will be around 18.5%, with expecting that our tax will represent 72% of our total budget. I give the rest of my presentation to my colleague, Mr. Ahmed Kosho, to complete the presentation.
Thank you, Your Excellency. And as explained, I mean, this very balanced approach in dealing with the economy and with the public finance had very positive news and very positive outcomes on the lease side of the economy. It's also there is a very good news also on the revenue side. Now we're talking about the expenditure side and, of course, interest payment, which remain to be one of our most important challenges and chapter that we're working on. It's very important to highlight that the effort that was done there. We are now working on all aspects of containing our debt service. We were able to bring it down significantly as a percent of GDP and as a percent of total expenditure. Still, we have a long way ahead of us, but to bring it down from 40% of total expenditure to 31% this fiscal year, and to bring it down from almost 10% of GDP to around 8.8 last fiscal year at 8% this year is a big achievement, and we need to continue with that. We did that while reducing the cost of borrowing. And we did that while we have extended our debt profile significantly by issuing more bonds rather than bills, so issuing more long-term securities rather than short-term securities. And as you can see in this slide, our average profile or average time to maturity or average profile of our debt has increased significantly from almost 2 years in 2016-2015 to now above 3 years to 3.3 years last June, and we want to take it to 3.7 years by the end of next June. This allowed us to bring down the gross financing needs of Egypt from above 55% or almost 55% to 32% or 34% last fiscal year. 39% last fiscal year and 34% this fiscal year, and we want to take it to below the 30% in the next 2 years. By doing that, the flip side of that is that we are creating space, and we are directing this space to the priority of the government, which is investment and public investment and public infrastructure is the top priority for that. We have the chapter on public investment or government investment has increased significantly and consistently over the last years. It increased fourfold between 2015, 16, and 2021, and it's the fastest growing item. On all our expenditure side, the investment reached now 20% of our fiscal envelope, up from less than 9% 3-4 years ago. This has led to this improvement in our expenditure structure. And we're mentioning that because we're not only that we were able to manage the economy, not only were we able to improve our headlines, public finance headlines, but we also have now improved the structure and the efficiency of our spending structure. As you can see, the interest payment is the only chapter that we still need to continue working on. But other than that, the shape and the structure of our expenditure is in a much healthier position now. And we always use this slide to tell the narrative of the entire story. In 13-14, pre-reforms, we used to spend 115 billion on education and health, human capital, and we used to spend 140 billion on energy. So we used to spend more on energy than we spend on human capital. Last fiscal year, which ended last June, we spent 252 billion on education and health, more than double what we used to spend in 2014, but also we're spending only 18 billion now on petroleum and electricity. So all the savings that were realized were redirected again to education and health, and there is now a much better spending structure in Egypt for the people. The current year budget has four pillars guiding our budget and our allocations, and those pillars are supporting the economic recovery, especially manufacturing and export, and maintaining discipline as in the past years, while also using all the available space to spend more on human capital as well as on social protection and improving the public services. So we have a lot of initiatives that are trying to allow us to achieve those four pillars together. Of course, we cannot mention all of them, but here are some of the examples about how we are trying to support the export and the manufacturing sector, whether by also bearing some of the cost of lower energy costs for them. So we're bearing it on their behalf to our Ministry of Electricity and the Ministry of Petroleum, or putting and giving more cash to our exporters in return for the due payments for them, or having a new battery fund system, or even a new system that was being prepared and that will have a very speedy battery fund system that will be announced very soon, or our big initiative of replacing old cars and vehicles using octane to new vehicles that's using natural gas, and hopefully also electrical vehicles very soon, that also can help and facilitate this transition. We have also the Hayaka Rima, or the Decent Life Initiative that actually the minister mentioned in the beginning. Basically, 4,500 villages in Egypt, we are turning them around totally. 50% of Egyptians living in rural Egypt will feel the benefit of everything, from inner roads, from productivity gains in agriculture, from health and education services, from sanitation and water usages, everything. And this is a huge initiative. We are putting $90 billion this fiscal year, and more to come in the next years. And we have also all the social protection measures, as well as paying the pension funds now the due payments on annual basis. We have the JP Morgan Index inclusion here as an initiative. Now it's a reality. We have today the announcement by the JP Morgan officially that Egypt bonds will be officially joining the index by end of next January. After a survey that was done with investors, with 90% of investors confirming that Egypt should be in the index with a very also decent weight, that's almost 2%. This is great news for us. Ukraine also was allowed to join with a weight of 0.1%, and with 60% of investors supporting the inclusion of Ukraine. So that's how India will be on the watch list. So we're very proud of this news, and this is very, very great news for us. Just before ending and talking about what Hisham have mentioned in the beginning about the challenges and how we deal with them, let's have 1 minute where we talk about Egypt comparison with peers. And as you see, last fiscal year that ended June, we did very well in terms of our primary balance. We did very well compared to all other emerging markets, where we were able to rise the primary surplus despite all the challenges. We were able also to bring down the deficit for Egypt for the last 4 years consistently, and we were able to bring it down to 7.4% of GDP. And now, if we look at Egypt compared not only to individual countries but even to lots, I think now we are one of the best countries globally in terms of rising primary surpluses. And now even our deficit now is lower than the average for emerging economies. I mean, for those who have followed Egypt for the last years, you know how big achievement is this. If you compare Egypt in 2014 or 15 or even after that and to what we have achieved last year, this is a remarkable achievement. What is still remaining to work on is the debt service, because it's remained very high even compared to countries that has very similar debt or even higher debt. And that's why we're working on the JP Morgan inclusion, on the improving the competitiveness of our and of our primary leader system, of the euro clearability, and all the effort that we're doing. But it's not that easy, also given that we are extending our debt profile. So we're trying to have this balance, so we might keep doing this very gradual approach that we are following over the last years. And now turning to the challenges. Yes, it's not an easy time, but it was also not an easy time for us to do all the reforms of the last years. And I think we have shown even during the COVID that we are managing our public finance with a lot of discipline and managing the economy in a very balanced way. So we're not anymore talking about those challenges without solutions. Yes, there will be an impact like other emerging markets, but we are also very aware about those challenges, and we have built some also very important instruments in Egypt that allow us to deal with some of those issues, including the commodity crisis. For example, we have now fuel indexation that is working, we have hedging systems, we have a risk management team that are working on that. We have the in terms of even the cost of borrowing, we have the diversification policy that we are following. So we have a lot of instruments that can allow us to mitigate or reduce the impact. But again, we're an emerging market and we face what other countries face. But we have now, we have built this agility and this also resilience over the last years through instruments and through policies. Our medium-term objectives are remain to be very balanced, but also very ambitious, but realistic also, or at least optimism around it is based on our previous performance. We want to take the economy to grow to close to 6% over the medium term while reducing jobs and creating adequate and decent jobs. We want to maintain the fiscal discipline while also supporting the manufacturing and the export activities, as well as use all the fiscal space available to increase our and improve our public finance, our public infrastructure, public service delivery, as well as social programs. To do that, we need enablers, and one of the biggest enablers is digitalization and automation. Its Excellency is have already pushed very hard there across all dimensions, on the customs, on the taxes, on the real estate, very soon. And now we're talking about things and not only talking about plans. We're talking about things that have been delivered, things that are now operational. Yes, we sometimes do things on a gradual phases or over phases, but we have now all taxpayers are submitting their tax returns electronically. They are now paying electronically. They are even uploading their e-receipts for all companies at the large taxpayer's office for all their B2B invoices. We have now the EC receipts that is now also a reality that will be fully functional, or will be start rolling out before the end of this fiscal year for all receipts by taxpayers. They can upload it for their business to consumer activities. We have the ACI that you are all aware about, and we have now the integration that will take place. This is what allowed us in the first 3 months of this fiscal year, for example, to have our tax revenues growing by almost 17.4% without even changing anything in the tax rates. So it's working, and it's only the beginning of more widening of our tax base and of fair and efficient collection, as well as repayment and refund for our taxpayers. We are structuralizing our reform by having a medium-term revenue strategy, by having a modern PFM law that is now in the cabinet and in the parliament for discussion. We are in the middle of the discussion with the parliament, and it's a new modern law that upgrades our ability to manage the public finance in a very modern way by having all the best practices and best principles adopted in this law. We are hoping that this should also be a reality very soon. And finally, we have our medium-term revenue strategy and medium-term debt strategy, both guiding our policies over the medium term. And on the revenue side, we are targeting additional revenue of around 2% of GDP by working on the automation, by working on the policy reforms, by bringing also best practices on the international taxation, as well as on the domestic taxation, by also including growing sectors and important sectors like e-commerce and e-trade. But this is also OECD, IMF, World Bank are working with us there, and we are following also their advice to make sure that all what we're doing is also abiding by international best practices. And on the debt strategy, our target is to bring the debt to 85% of GDP by the medium term, to continue extending our debt profile to close to 5 years over the medium term, and also to continue managing the risks and reducing the gross financing needs of the country in a very good way. Eurocredibility is one. Diversification is the broad theme there. And we are working left and right on having Sukuk law now. We have worked on the green bond issuances. We want to work also on sustainable development bond issuances, on the Eurocredibility, And now JP Morgan, even this slide, of course, is obsolete. We used to have it before the announcement today. So this is not anymore a plan or initiative. This is now a reality. We're very proud of that. And we will maintain our effort to keep bringing more competition and more visibility and more attraction to our also bond market and domestic market. With that, we will stop here. And thank you for your attention.
I don't know whether you would like me to comment on the points mentioned by Mr. Hisham, which I believe were price of oil, price of commodity, interest rate, and I think also private sector, something like that, or wait to receive other comments and reply to all together. Steve, back to you.
No, well, Your Excellency, we did have one question submitted in advance, and we'll definitely be interested to hear your perspectives on those issues, and then we'll definitely want to open it up. But if you do have any, you know, kind of top line thoughts on those kind of big macro perspectives, I think they're of interest and germane to everybody online. So please, by all means.
Thank you very much. Let me say that the current situation is very uncertain with what is going on around the world. Higher inflation environment started to be dominating the situation, as we can see oil products and commodities prices are increasing. Of course, all of these are affecting us as a cost of financing, affecting us as a pressure on the budget to deal with such deviation on what were our assumptions when we prepared our budget. We normally prepare our budget in March of every year to submit it to the parliament before the end of the March, and normally we started the budget in July. So we didn't expect that level of prices for oil and that. However, we are addressing that because of our reserves. We have reserves, so we are trying to manipulate this period by trying to use all our means to smooth the situation. Let me say that we are currently exporting natural gas, and this is bringing us some hard currencies, which I believe is helping us. Also, we have increased domestic prices in order to reflect the increased prices in oil in the Brent. So we increased over the last six months three times the oil prices, domestic oil prices there. I believe the public is accepting that because of what is going on around the world. This is helping us. Also last year, we imposed green fees on oil, which also the revenue we are getting last year, which was as a result of reduction in oil prices. So we used, we imposed green fees on using oil. So all of that. In addition, that we are moving on a very ambitious plan to replace the cars using solar and octane by natural gas. I think roughly every month we change something between 500 to 1,000 cars, which is also will help in reducing using oil. Let me say that interest rate also is a pressure, because we've seen that when we went to the international markets to issue euro bonds 3 weeks ago, we saw increasing in the requested interest. I think the 6 years was increasing by 1.5 to 2%, and the same for 12 years bonds. So there was an increasing cost of borrowing internationally. Locally, still the same level. We are still managing the cost of local borrowing fairly reasonable. I believe until now, we are not that very much worried about the macroeconomic outlook. We're still managing. And I have to say one word. We have had an experience to deal with such a situation, because twice over the last 3 years, we've been to such shocks. I remember October, December 2018, with the crisis of emerging markets, and we were affected negatively. $20 billion left Egypt, and we were under pressure from international market and local market, and we addressed that, and we moved smoothly once we moved on 2019. Again, in 2020, since March 2020 with COVID-19, up to June, we were in a very shock. More than $22, $23 billion left the country. We were under pressure. No export remittance from Egyptians, nothing from the tourism sector. We were under huge pressure over the period of March to June 2020, and we dealt with it, and we moved after that. We hope this time we will be managing the same crisis. And until now, I believe that we are putting this uncertainty and this high inflation, oil prices, commodity price, and under control. I hope this will last longer. If it is 3-6 months, I think it is manageable. And I always say we are risk managers rather than Minister of Finance or anything else. So this is my comment. I leave my colleague Ahmed if you would like.
I think that is all, Your Excellency. And the bottom line is that that we as a team here, His Excellency leading us, we are not. We have a very strong team that is following what's happening, and we are always pushing very hard for mitigation measures. And we are in action, not only analyzing deviations and shocks and witnessing them, but we are always trying to be in action and trying to minimize and mitigate things as much as possible.
Well, thank you both. I mean, you've really given us such a comprehensive presentation, and in many respects, kind of the top line. The indicators are going in the right direction. It was very interesting also to hear about the Hari Kareem, the Decent Life Initiative, and how that's progressing and how important that is, and the accolades, obviously, from the World Bank. I do want, in the remaining time we have, I want to go, I see hands up from Todd Wilcox at HSBC, Tomer at Baker Hughes, and then Van at Cargill. And then we had one question submitted to us, and we see if we have any other. I'm looking to Anna. We may have another hand as well. But first, we'll go Todd, then Tomer.
Thank you, Steve. And thank you, Dr. Maait. And just a very fast question. On with COP26 coming and COP27 being here in Egypt and a priority for the global economy and global businesses, what do you see? Where do you see your ministry going next year in terms of driving the economy and the sustainability agenda? And what's the role of private sector? And I guess specifically, you know, we're in banking. We've got a very public net zero targets, as many banks do. What do you see as our role in the Egypt economy for the year to come?
And Todd, let's take another question too. From Baker Hughes, so we'll get two in at once here. So Tomer, let me add you to that as well.
Thank you so much, Steve. Good evening, Your Excellency, Mr. Kojic. Actually, my question was in the same direction of Todd's. So it's about energy transition. We're an energy technology company, and we're interested in energy transition. We're seeing lots of initiatives. Agreements on studying the potential of energy transition, especially with hydrogen projects. So the question was targeting the what are the plans of financing those projects.